Wow, what an enjoyable, healthy, great meal I had. I hope you did too. Aldit, how was your lunch?
Oh, it was great.
I didn't want to stop eating, but I remember there was something better than my physical food that I had to come back for. What do you say?
Yes, I was filled spiritually in the morning, and now I am filled also with the physical food. And I am ready for the last part of our program. Brace yourself. It still is a wonderful thing that we're going to present to you this afternoon.
So stay tuned, and we ask that as you're filled physically, you will anxiously await this program to be more blessed spiritually this afternoon, and we will not disappoint you. So, just as your lunch was not a disappointment, be sure this program will not be disappointing for you. So welcome back, stay tuned. You will not be able to say, I have missed it, because this is important for you.
Masterpiece, chosen, loved, and written by His Happy Sabbath, a brief walk with faithful and inspiring women of the Bible. Jochebed, mother of Moses. Many of us all know about the story of Moses, hidden for 3 months by his mother. She saw a good child, Jochebed, and her older daughter Miriam put baby Moses in a waterproof papyrus basket. And the young Moses was found by Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him. An opportunity arose when a nurse was needed. Smart Miriam suggested her mother to take up the task. For 12 years, Moses was brought up by his biological mother. This is where we draw from Jochebed, a woman who knew God. It is also correct to assume that during those formative years, Moses was exposed and taught about the true God of Israel. In Patriarchs and Prophets, Jochebed earnestly prayed and committed her son to God. Moses' life was preserved and her faith was rewarded. Moses later came to be of service to the Lord's people. Ruth. Naomi was a woman of faith, even with the loss of her husband and 2 sons. Naomi got a message that the famine in Israel was over, so she strived to move back from Moab to Israel with Ruth and her daughter-in-law. Ruth stood by Naomi, got to learn about the God of Israel. Even though Naomi's biological children died, her blessings were renewed through her daughter-in-law. Ruth got married to Naomi's kinsman Boaz. It's through this lineage that the Messiah was born. This is a story inspiring women to seek God, and in his blessings are never late. God's plan was bigger than that of Naomi and Ruth would have imagined. They became the chosen lineage fit for our Messiah. The story of the nameless woman, only defined as a bleeding woman in Luke, is an inspiration of faith. The woman had suffered for 12 years, making her physically sick, shamed, socially unacceptable. She had seen most of the physicians of her time, but with no appease, with nothing more to spare, she heard about Christ's healing power. She learned of him and set on a journey for 30 miles. Amongst the crowd, she finds her way and touches the garment. She immediately receives healing. We draw encouragement from the woman's faith in Jesus, made her receive healing, and Christ acknowledged her. Christ actually knew who she was. Hannah was was the first wife of Elkanah, while Peninnah was the second. Hannah was childless, the most beloved. Peninnah got 10 sons and 2 daughters. During which time she mocked Hannah. In her pain, Hannah didn't retaliate to Peninnah or Elkanah. She took her pain to the Lord and she prayed persistently for God to open her womb. A priest at the temple mistakenly thought she was drunk with wine. She begot child Samuel and made a promise to dedicate the child back to God, Prophet Samuel. Peninnah is an incredible woman. She is a testimony to total surrender and endurance in prayer. God changed the mourning and sadness into blessings. As I come to a close, we'll be praying for teachers, pastors, and essential workers that God's mighty blessings bless them as they reach out to others. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you are kind, you are loving, Lord. There is nothing that you cannot change. You change the seasons as we see them, Father. We remember the events of the birth of Samuel and the mom and how they prayed, and Moses' parents, Lord, Father, and you took care of them. May you cover this special people in our lives, our teachers, Father. May you give them wisdom. Our pastors, may you give them knowledge of spreading the word and the comfort that they give to others, Father. May they be vessels of understanding and spreaders of your love, Lord, Father. May they be examples of the community, Father. Lord, King of Glory, may you cover the the essential workers, Father. May you give them protection from above, Father. We glorify you, Father, because you know them before they were even born. in the wombs of their moms, you knew them, Father. We glorify you at this time.
Hi, my name is Elena Barnhill Moffitt, and I've been in the New Jersey Conference now for over 25 years. And I teach at Lake Nelson Adventist Academy, and I'm the vice principal there, and I teach, I'm a homeroom teacher for eighth grade. And I was baptized when I was 19 years old and had gone to Pacific Union College. And I just wanted to share a little bit of my background with you because it's interesting how God uses us and guides us to do many different things. So when I went to Pacific Union College, I had not heard of this group called Pathfinders. And the more I started learning about this group of youth that worked together to learn all kinds of activities, outdoor activities, as well as biblical activities, I began to get very excited about it. I had soon gotten married and moved down back to New Jersey and started to have my own family. And there, my husband, Anthony Moffitt, and he started working with the Pathfinders. And then later, I began to work with Pathfinders as my children got older. I'm sharing that because I never knew that God would take something like Pathfinders, the skills that I learned in that program, and to use it for His glory in the future. This past year, September 1st, we were all hit in New Jersey by a strong hurricane, Hurricane Ida. And it was a day that many of us, at least in my area, we knew it was going to rain, but we didn't realize, we hadn't taken notice that there was going to be a big hurricane. And so when this rain started coming early that evening, and I remember being at an appointment, and I came out of the appointment, and the water just in the little street that I was on was really beginning to flow. And as I took my foot and stepped to get into my car, my feet were completely covered in water. And I thought, boy, this is a heavy rain. I was able to make it home that day, and came home and started to make my dinner, and it was early in the evening, around 7 o'clock. Around 8:30, something told me, you know what, go outside and see what's going on. When I opened the front door, I saw my neighbor. My neighbor's name is Chris Band, and he's new to me as a neighbor. And I saw him walking in the yard, and it was something unusual because the water was about up to his ankles, and he had his firefighter outfit on. And I looked and I said, wow, what's going on? And he said, look at the water that's coming down. It's coming down really hard. So I said, okay. I went back into the house and I figured out, let me see what else is going on. And so I went upstairs, and when I went upstairs to look out of my window, the second story window, I discovered that the street that I lived on, which is really three doors down from Lake Nelson Adventist Academy, the entire street was flooded and the water was extremely high and it was running like fast, swift water. And so I went back downstairs and I opened the door again and I looked at my neighbor and I said, let me get dressed. Let me see if I can help. So I got dressed, put on some warm clothes on, a big jacket, and I went outside and I said, how can I help? And my neighbor said, well, there's a man across the street who can't swim and he needs some help. And there's a few other men that are on the other side of the road and they're also yelling. He said, but the one across the way over here, you can hear him yelling. He's the one I'm worried about because he can't swim. And I said, well, how can I help? And so I happened to have a canoe in my yard, not happened, but God blessed me with a canoe. And so I said, he said, could we use your boat to help this man? And I said, of course. So I went and I got the canoe. And as we walked in the water, even in my backyard, was already up to our, it was up to our ankles, but it was getting, as we carried the canoe to the side of the house towards his part of the yard, the water was started to get a little bit deeper and it reached my knees. When it got to my knees, I decided to get into the canoe. My neighbor decided to stand on the top and he says, okay, we have to come rescue this guy. We've got to do what we can to get to him. So my neighbor chose to stay outside of the canoe and he was walking and as I was paddling with him next to him, and the water reached slowly reached to his thighs and then it reached to his neck. And now he is swimming alongside as I'm paddling. We got towards the street and the water was so high and moving so fast that we saw the person. We started to go towards him, but the water was so fast that we went right by him and couldn't grab him. As the water continued down the road, if you went further down the road, my neighbor was able to stand on the street, even though he was still neck deep in water, and we were able to go to the next door neighbor's house where the water got receded more, and we were able to go up onto their embankment and try again to save this guy. As we walked up my neighbor's yard, the water receded because the water didn't reach my next door neighbor's house on the other side. And so we said, we got to do this again. This time I thought, okay, let me get my personal flotation device. I have one for this man just in case I can at least give this to him as we're trying to reach him again. And so we try this thing again. We go behind my house, in between the two of our houses. Again, the water's reaching higher and higher as we're moving down towards the street. As we get into the street again, my neighbor decides to stay outside to try to help the canoe, steer the canoe while I'm in the back paddling the canoe. This time we jetted straight across the street as the waters would carry us down to where this man was. When I saw him, he looked like he was holding on to a telephone pole. That's what it appeared like to me. We were able to reach him, and I remember grabbing him and holding on to him. And as he began to grab onto me and try to grab onto the canoe capsized. And so all three of us are in the water now. I'm holding the man around his neck about right here. He's holding the canoe, I was holding the canoe, and my neighbor was kind of directing the canoe in front. And we were able to get down the street again. As we were riding down, we were finally able to feel the ground beneath us as the water was still carrying us and the canoe now upside down, down the road. We were able to get back up onto my neighbor's land and walk slowly up till we got to near the front of the doors where we tried to pull the canoe back up and it was just beached with water. We could not do anything more with that. But we were able to walk the man to the front doors of the steps of my neighbors. They have a little bit of a landing, so we were able to stand up there where he was able to rest. When I tell you, he was scared. He had never learned to swim. He was standing, he told me that he was standing at the roof of his car, so his entire car was submerged underwater. And he just kept saying how thankful he was. I stayed with him for a while. My neighbor went to go try to help other people. But because the water was coming so far, he was not even able to help the other people. But the gentleman that I stayed with, to just kind of calm him down as he was able to breathe and relax a little bit, but just, it was a fearful thing. He said he thought his life was, he was gonna die. He thought this would be the end of his life. And he was so thankful that we were able to help rescue him. And my second neighbor eventually opened the door. We didn't knock on her door because we were just trying to calm him down. And we startled my neighbor and she said, "Elena, what are you doing? Why didn't you guys knock on the door?" And honestly, I said, we were just talking and I was trying to calm him down, so it just felt better just to rest there. But we eventually brought him into the house. I was able to go to my own home and bring some clothes for him to wear. And he just kept saying, "Boy, I thought I was gonna die." And I said, "Well, do you believe in God?" And he kind of looked at me and he said, "Well, no, I'm not a believer." And I said, "Well, I could tell you God exists, and there's a special reason that he had me save you." I said, "At this moment, God loves you and he didn't want you to perish. It wasn't your time. And so I hope that you're able to get to know Christ as your personal savior. He's kind, he's loving, and he's not forceful. He's not gonna force himself on you. He's gonna wait and introduce you to him, and he's there for you." The man felt relief. And that night he was able to stay with my neighbors while I had gone back to my home, but he was very thankful. The next day we were able to go outside. It was about 8 a.m. All of the water had receded. There was at least 3 cars in front of my house, all one way and another way because of the waters and the way the waters were so high. The neighbor's car, I saw that he had, the man who we had rescued, his car was across the street and it was pushed up against a telephone pole. And I could see now that he was standing on top when I thought that he was just grabbing onto that telephone pole. Well, I started our story sharing that I never knew that pathfinders would give me the skills that I was able to help rescue a man. And I'll tell you, in Pathfinders and working with Master Guide, I had learned how to canoe, how to camp, how to kayak, how to also lead people to Christ and to leave many other adults, give them something exciting to live for. I enjoy adventure and I was excited to know that God was able to give me the skills to use not just for my own enjoyment, but also to help save another person. There's something else I'd like to say, because I don't know if there's any youth that are listening, but I remember going to Union, I think it's Union, Lincoln, Nebraska, Union College, and they had a very special degree that you could get. It's part of a nursing degree, but it was called International Rescue Relief. And I thought, boy, if I could ever go back to school again, or if I did decide to go back to school and do some type of nursing, that I would want to do this career because it gives you the rescue skills you need, like how to help save people when they're in an area where we don't have free medical help or ready medical help available to us, where we have to climb down into canyons and help create like a litter for someone to bring them back up to safety. They teach you all kinds of skills that you can use and make a career out of it. And so I thought, boy, this is a great thing. Our church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, has a great, wonderful message. And we have so many different programs that can help people in need. So I hope that you make yourself available, that you allow God to use you and your skills and in any way he wants. He's calling us. He's ready for us to help. And I hope that we open ourselves up to help him and use the skills that God's given us to help others. I'm thankful for my school, Lake Nelson Adventist Academy, because it's a great place to be able to share all kinds of skills with our students and to encourage them to try all kinds of different things. I do the same things in our churches too with our Pathfinders groups and even with the Master Guide groups. I'm thankful for so much God has given us and to be able to give back to God and to our people. Thank you for listening, and I hope that you were blessed by this message.
Created for a mission, I was brought to this world to preach to every kindred of his mercy and love. In every kindness I show, in everything that I do, I've been chosen by my God to testify. A woman of God, his masterpiece, chosen, loved, and redeemed by his love. A new life I was given to serve. I accept your call. Here I am, my Lord. Wherever I go, I will tell, and forever will I shout and sing. Lord, I will. About his redemptive love, sharing God's love and mercy, forgiveness and joy. I will not be afraid, God is walking by my side. I will go forward with his might, the ending is near. I will masterpiece, chosen, loved, and redeemed by his love. A new life I was given to serve. I accept your call. Here I am, my Lord. Wherever I go, I will tell, and forever will I shout and sing. Lord, I will go. Masterpiece, chosen, loved, and redeemed by his love.
Wow, that was such a tremendous testimony. And what great singing by Kelly Pastor. I'm sure that your lives were blessed the same as mine. How about you, Aldit?
I am so blessed with that singing and so far with everything that's going on in the program.
Yes.
I am filled.
I am so happy because if you're not happy, I'm not also. So I am so blessed that you're with me today and you have enjoyed everything so far. And also all those who are online, our visitors, our friends, and all of our members in New Jersey Conference, they were blessed also. But it's not done yet. I wonder what we have to present now.
Our topic now is I Will Go Believing Without Seeing.
Wow, believing without seeing.
That's difficult.
Yes, it is. But you know what? It's taking us back to those times when God led his people. And although they passed through like terrible times, mm-hmm. we can see that God was with them because they believe. Even though sometimes they did not see him, his presence was not exactly there before them. So we can understand that we should have faith. Whatever comes our way, we should not give up because we know without faith, it is impossible to please God. So let us remember that although we are not seeing what God is doing, we can feel it. We have faith. And we know we surely will overcome.
Yes. Yes. So, Olga, can you tell us about our next speaker?
Oh, what a tremendous lady. She has been working for a very long time. And although now she is retired, she still finds the strength, the honor, everything she has inside to bless us. So, today, we will have with us Dr. Gonzalez, and I will give you some more information about her.
I'm excited.
Yes. So, Miriam Salcedo de Gonzalez is a retired pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Southern California. She had previously worked as a Bible worker, evangelist, teacher, educational counselor, and school administrator.
Wow.
That was a mouthful.
Yes.
And we know that with all she did in the past, she continues to serve God. She was born in Cuba. Her father is a retired pastor, and so is her husband, Luis A. Gonzalez. He also was a pastor. She has two sons, Abdiel and Gadiel. Her passion is preaching the gospel of salvation. And we can see through all her experience that she really loves God. If it was not by faith, she could have not done all of this. Let us listen.
I can't wait.
Yes. And let us have faith because God is still with us. With us now, Dr. Miriam Gonzalez.
Hello, friends. I wish I could be with you in person today, but from the distance, we are loving each other, and more than anything else, we are loving our Lord, praising his name, and enjoying just receiving more and more of his word. I will go sharing my legacy. We like to think that our life will not be lived in vain, that somewhere, somehow, someone will live a different life because we share with them our love for God. And they also see how God is able to change their lives. So, consciously or unconsciously, we are sharing our legacy with those who are by our side. First, our family, our neighbors, our friends, our coworkers, all of them see us and wonder, why is this person different? And yes, you want to share your legacy with friends and coworkers, but above everybody else, we want to be there with our families when Jesus comes. Every person is a world. Our story is different from anybody else. Today, however, there is something that if not all, most of us want and pray. And as I say, we pray for our children. If you don't have children, you pray for your nephew. If you don't have nephews, you pray for someone whom you know, a child that you want to see walking in the path of the Lord. Let's share today a Bible story about a very well-known man. This happened before the time of the king, so it's related in the book of Judges. It was 15 judges in the people of Israel before the kings. Actually, one of them was that famous woman, Deborah. And Deborah was not only a judge, she was also a prophetess, and she was a warrior. She was an amazing woman of God. And that's how God leads us in the different aspects of our life. You don't have to be a prophet. You don't have to be a warrior. You don't have to be anything, but just what God wants you to be, who he wants you to be. So this woman was part of those 15 judges of Israel. After this parenthesis, open your Bibles on the book of Judges, and we're going to read on chapter 13, and we're going to start in verse 2. He says, "Now there was a certain man from Zorah of the family of the Danites, whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and had no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, 'Indeed, now you are barren and have borne no children, but you shall conceive and bear a son. Now, therefore, please be careful not to drink wine or similar drink, or not to eat anything unclean, for behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. And no razor shall come upon his head, for the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb. And he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines.' So the woman came and told her husband, saying, 'A man of God came to me, and his countenance was like the countenance of the angel of God, very awesome. But I did not ask him where he was from, and he did not tell me his name. And he said to me, "Behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. Now drink no wine or similar drink, nor eat anything unclean, for the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb to the day of his death." Then Manoah said, "Wonderful, my dear wife." No, he just turned around and knelt down. He wanted to talk to God. Because in those days, the testimony of a woman was not accepted. Only men can testify. And how can she be coming and saying, "I saw an angel of the Lord"? So Manoah prayed to the Lord and said, "Oh, my Lord, please let the man of God whom you sent come to us again and teach us what we shall do for the child who will be born." Of course, the angel of the Lord had already done that, but with Mrs. Manoah, not with him. And God listened to the voice of Manoah, and the angel of God came to the woman again as she was sitting in the field. To the woman again, that's what the Bible says. Yeah, the angel of the Lord came back to Mrs. Manoah. So Manoah, her husband, was not with her, the Bible says. So the woman ran in haste and told her husband and said to him, "Look, the man who came to me the other day has just now appeared to me." So Manoah rose, followed his wife, and when he came to the man, he said to him, "Are you the man who spoke to this woman?" And he said, "I am." Manoah said, "Now let your words come to pass. What will be the boy's rule of life and his work?" So the angel of the Lord said to Manoah, "Of all that I said to the woman, let her be careful. She may not eat anything that comes from the vine, nor may she drink wine or similar drink, nor eat anything unclean. All that I commanded her, let observe." Then Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, "Please, let us detain you, and we will prepare a young goat for you." And the angel of the Lord said to Manoah, Though you detain me, I will not eat your food. But if you offer a burnt offering, you must offer it to the Lord. For Manoah did not know he was the angel of the Lord. Then Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, "What is your name, that when your words come to pass, we may honor you?" And the angel of the Lord said to him, "Why do you ask my name, seeing it is wonderful?" So Manoah took the young goat with the grain offering, offered it upon the rock to the Lord. And he did a wondrous thing while Manoah and his wife looked on. It happened as the flame went up toward heaven from the altar, the angel of the Lord ascended in the flame of the altar. When Manoah and his wife saw this, they fell on their faces to the ground. When the angel of the Lord appeared no more to Manoah and his wife, then Manoah knew that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to his wife, "We shall surely die, because we have seen God." But his wife, wise woman that she was, said to him, "If the Lord had desired to kill us, he would have not accepted a burnt offering and a grain offering from our hands, nor would he have shown us all these things, nor he have told us such things as this at this time." So the woman bore a son and called him Samson. And the child grew, and the Lord blessed him. And the Spirit of the Lord began to move upon him at Mahane Dan, between Zorah and Eshtaol. That's the story on the Bible. And what we see here is that at that time, as I already said, a woman's testimony was not accepted. So that's why Manoah needed to hear himself what the angel was saying. The interesting thing, as I mentioned, is that Manoah is the one who prays and the angel comes back to Mrs. Manoah. And she's the one who had to run home and bring him back. And at the same time, let's meditate for one moment on some aspects of the story. Israel has gone after false gods, but God comes to them. Sometimes we have heard that God will not be with us when we are not following his word. However, we find in the Bible that God came to Adam and Eve after they sinned. He came to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. He's always coming, he's always calling, because we are his creation and he loves us with eternal love. We are sinners and we sin. We are not sinners because we sin. We sin because we are sinners. And that is what happened. That's what Jesus came so we can have eternal life. We couldn't live without sinning. So Jesus came like the first Adam. Adam and Eve could have lived without sinning. They could have had eternal life. They did not have a tendency to sin. They were created perfect. And we were created by God to live a perfect life. But sin enter, and that made the difference. Before Adam and Eve could have lived without sinning, now we cannot live without sinning. We sin because we are sinners. Paul says in Romans chapter 7, 24 and 25, "O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ, our Lord." Then what? "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believes in him," what do we have to do? "Believe in him, shall not perish, but have eternal life." Yes, Jesus came. He lived a perfect life without sin. He gave his life in the cross. And that perfect life is credited to our account when God looks at our account that is filled with things that we did not want to commit, but we ended up doing things that we didn't even want to do, we will see that in the book of God will be crossed out and said, forgiven, 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 because Jesus came to die for us, and now we have life through him. Let's go back to our story with Samson. And we find out here that as a human being after the fall, he could not live without sinning. He was a child that came as a blessing to his parents, that was called my son. Not my son, my son, the son in heaven, the son that brings bright light to the world. So he was a judge of Israel for 20 years, constantly going from sinning to more sinning. He married women who were not followers of the God who sent him to this earth as a special child. He played with the enemies of Israel. He did everything that would show him up his strength and his intelligence, but not his God. The judge of Israel ends up in the hands of his enemies. His hair has been cut, therefore he's weak. After all those years, the last thing that we hear from him is a prayer. Let's read the last part of the story in chapter 16, verses 28 to 31. Then Samson prayed to the Lord. Sovereign Lord, remember me. Please, God, strengthen me just once more, and let me with one blow get revenge on the Philistine for my two eyes. That's what he wanted, revenge for his two eyes. Then Samson reached toward the two center pillars on which the temple stood, bracing himself against them, his right hand on the one and his left hand on the other. Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." Then he pushed with all his might, and down came the temple and the rulers and all the people in it. Thus, he killed many more when he died than while he lived. Then his brothers and his father's whole family went down to get him. They brought him back and buried him between Zoran Eshtaol in the tomb of Manoah, his father. He had led Israel for 20 years. The end. The story is finished. It's done. He was conceived, he was born, he fasted, he was bad, he played, he liked to just toy with people. He wanted to show his strength to everyone, even to his wives, and ended up dying with the Philistines. What a story. What a story in the book of the Judges. The end, right? Wrong. Well, that's all that the book of Judges has to say about Samson. Then what? What about the promises that God gave his parents? The Bible story ends saying that he killed more people with his death than with his life. Can you imagine? The son. How did his family feel seeing everything that Samson had done? So there it ends. He is in a tomb. Now we come to a word which is not used in this story, but it means everything throughout it. And that word is grace. And I will say amazing grace. In the Judges' days, when the light of God's love and his message was almost totally obscured by the disobedience of the children of Israel, when there was almost no faith, God raised a son. Israel is in apostasy. God refuses to leave them. his sacred name, he said, for his sacred name, he has to save his people. But his grace and his name are being ignored by his own people. Then God sent the Son. Samson came as the liberator. His story is longer than any other story about the judges, even when he did less than all his predecessors. He's born as a gift from God with a special mission. He, however, lives like a bandit, a deceiver who does not appreciate his calling. He only appreciates his strength. So Samson ends as a blind, undignified prisoner. But that's not really the end. At the end, his last conversation, his last words were with God, toward God. The Bible doesn't mention anything to let us know if his relatives who buried him knew the future. But God knew and knows. Samson's story does not end on Judges chapter 16, verse 31. We have to go to the New Testament, to the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, the chapter of the faith, the heroes and heroines of faith. Let's read verses 32 to 40. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, gained what was promised, who shut the mouth of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced years and flogging and evil chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us, all of them together with us, will they be made perfect. That will happen when Jesus comes. We will be with all of them, all of us, by the grace of God, and we will go with our sons and our daughters, with our families, with our children, because no one could have probably told Mrs. Manoah or Mr. Manoah that that son who was just always with the Philistines, that son that was always with women who were against the God whom they served, that son that only thought about playing with people and killing goats and killing animals and killing people if he had to do it, but nothing else. Who was going to tell them? How would they say if they will now wake up, see the Bible, open it in Hebrews chapter 11, and read that Samson is one of those that are mentioned And the Bible said, through faith, conquer kingdoms, administer justice, and gain what was promised. They shut the mouths of the lions, quenched the fury of the flames, escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned into strength, who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Yes, Samson is in the list of the heroes and heroines of faith of Hebrews chapter 11. If somebody would have told that to his parents, to the people who knew him, they would have said, no way, no way. God is a just God. He loves his children. Definitely we know that. But this man had done too many bad things. And the only time that we read a prayer is when he is asking God to give him strength to kill all the Philistines, but to kill himself too. I don't understand. I don't know if you do, but I don't understand. I only know one thing, is that God so loved the world that he gave his begotten son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. And that's what happened. At that moment, somehow, Samson believed in him, and God counted that for justice. And he's going to be in the kingdom of heaven. And for the grace of God, you and I also will be there. But also, we'll go like Moses said to the Pharaoh. We will go with our children. We pray and we trust the Lord. We know that he is with us. There was a couple whom I knew since I was a child. They were very good friends with my parents. They have studied together, and both the men were pastors, and we always were together in every pastor's meetings when I was a child. And this couple have two boys and a girl, and they were at the church, and they were in the school, and they sang in quartets, and they were really good boys, apparently. The years went by, and both boys, now men, just went away from the Lord. For many years, they did not even want to hear anything about the Lord. I remember specifically the first time that I saw the younger of these two in an event that was happening with many of our friends who were together. And I came with such happiness to tell him, hey, how are you? I have not seen him in ages. And he looked around and looked at me and said, oh, hi. I say, what? He was not the same friend whom I loved and knew. His brother was the same. And I always thought about those parents. Several years later, the mother passed away. She was here in California, so I attended the funeral. And both of the sons were there. Same story with the younger son, but the older son has gone back to the Lord. And he was teaching and preaching the word of God. And it was amazing to see that happening. And his father was able to see that because he was still alive. They kept praying for the prodigal son. And finally, sometime later, the father also passed away. And we went to the funeral this time. And at that funeral, the prodigal son came home. And I cannot even wait for the moment when Jesus comes and we go into the mansions that he has prepared for us, because he has mansions prepared for us, you know, right? So we go into there and we start looking in different places, and Jesus is showing us the different doors on this, in this house. There lives your friend Anna, and in this house lives your friend Francis, and in this house, and you have all these different friends. Elizabeth, that just was just washing dishes and really big. Oh, yes. In the college in Cuba with me, all these people, we are there. And the Lord is telling us, he's your friend, and there's your friend, and there's your friend. And then we want to ask something, but we don't know if we should. We want to ask him, and we are just listening to all the people who are there that the Lord is telling us. And then suddenly we said, okay, Lord, hold on a second. I need to ask. What about my children? They went away. I have been praying for them and trying to be an example to them throughout my life. I have been just trying to see if they will follow you, but nothing has happened. The Lord just looked at me and said, hey, come with me. So we keep walking. He knocks on the door. The door opens, and there is my son. He knocks on the other door, and the door opens, and there is my other son. And the Lord says, I am going to fight for you, and I will save your children. Isaiah 49, verse 25. For I will contend with him who contends with you, and I will save your children. Jeremiah 31, verse says, this is what the Lord says. Restrain your voice from weeping and your eyes from tears, for your work will be rewarded, declares the Lord. They will return from the land of the enemy. So there is hope for your descendants, declares the Lord. Your children will return to their own land. Yes, my dear friends, let's just be there. You and I, with our children, our families, husbands, wives, friends, all of us together. And as Pastor Villanueva used to say, just at 3 p.m., the first Sabbath, let's get together by the Tree of Life and the big family of God. All of us reunited, all of us redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, will be together for eternity. May God bless all of us. Amen.
Wow. Thank you, Dr. Miriam. That was such an inspiring message. You see, Olga, her topic was about believing without seeing. I can't do that. Human as we are, we tend to see it in order to believe in it. But in the Bible, it says that's faith. So in Romans 8, verse 28, one of my favorite texts, it says, all things work together for good for them that love God. So it is very important to believe even though you don't see it. And when you believe and you learn to trust God, and within that power, you can share your legacy to others.
Oh, wow. Isn't that great? Because it said that in the Bible, Esther, if she did not have faith, she would not be able to stand before the king to save her people. Also, as we can see in Job, he said, even though you slay me, you kill me, I don't know the reason, but I will not give up trusting in you because I know you are the only Almighty. And also, we can see in Hannah, a person who wanted something so much. She trusted God. She said, I don't know, but I know that God can grant me what I want because I will, in return, give back this child to God. She had so much faith and belief in God. She didn't give up. And as we see, what a great prophet Samuel became. Yes. So you know what? No matter what happened, even though you're going through this turmoil, and then things might get so rough, you don't understand because you can't see your way through, there's no one to help you. Don't forget. Do not forget. Although you don't see, you know the presence of God is with you. Be sure He will never leave you nor forsake you.
Because faith is power.
Amen. Yes, indeed.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Now bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Lord, I come, I confess. Bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, Lord, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. When sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Oh, oh. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need. I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Hey, hey. You know what I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Hello, my name is Angela Jonas, and I attend the New Brunswick SDA Church. I am privileged to be a co-laborer for Christ and the challenges He is bringing into my path to purify my character. I must say I thought of myself as a calm person who do not really become anxious, but God showed me who I really was. In the middle of May 2020, my son graduated from an Adventist academy. To God be praise. At the end of May, he said, the best choice he can make to further his life is to join the military force, specifically the branch of the Marines. Since he did not plan to attend college immediately, automatically I began thinking of the dangers he may face in entering one of the frontline forces of this country, and also the influences in the service. I suggested the Navy, which is a less frontline combat organization. However, my son was convinced this is the branch he was most interested in for many reasons. I had mixed emotions about the situation, but I still remained calm. As the process continued, Odell diligently practiced physically to prepare for the next step, which was boot camp. It was 3 short months later, at the end of August, when my son said, Mom, the recruiters believe I am ready for boot camp. My son one day was looking up the activities, which was done in boot camp. And it made me nervous when I realized the length and intensity of the training he would endure to become a Marine. I recognized my fears, anxieties, and emotions when I was crying one morning on the prayer line. I disclosed to the group what was troubling me, and the leader for the prayer line, a woman of prayer and of God, recommended reading the Mark Bible and to make a prayer journal. My son left for boot camp at the end of August, and I started reading the Mark Bible and made a prayer journal. All the time I recited the scripture, Philippians 4:6, which says, be anxious for nothing, but in all things with prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. I totally disregarded that scripture because my anxiety level was built to the point one day I felt I could not breathe. For the first 2 weeks when Odell left for boot camp, I was fearful and anxious. I had to truly seek the Lord, and as I continued praying and reading the Mark Bible, God calmed my fears and showed me through especially nature scenes that Odell's life is safe in his hands and he is indeed mighty to save. I thank God he does not cast us off when we doubt his word and his love. God gave me a new focus and my fears he transformed into strengths. Now I am ready by the grace of God for the challenge of the journey in being a military mom. I trust that your life was enriched by this testimony. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word which cannot return unto you void. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. Please help those who are struggling with mental issues. Those who might be depressed, anxious, and those who have post-traumatic stress disorders, those who are contemplating suicide, allow them to trust you with their whole heart, not leaning on their own understanding. Allow them to think upon the things that are true, that are honest, that are just, that are pure, that are lovely, that are of good report. Father, I pray that they will experience your perfect peace as their minds remain stayed on you, as you promise in Isaiah 26. Thank you indeed for the many blessings from your hand. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, well, well. What a beautiful testimony from Angela. And also that music, I'm sure we were spirit-filled. What do you say, Aldith?
Yes, it was a very powerful testimony indeed. I really, really enjoyed it, and I was blessed.
Yes, and it is so important because our children need that really tough, important part of them, mental health. They need to understand that as long as God is there with them, they don't have to worry because they will be mentally stable. That was great.
Indeed, it is. So our next topic, which is our last topic of the day, will be given by Dr. Gamaliel Feliciano. What is the topic about?
Yes, it is, I will go believing in myself, and that is my auto-esteem. Very, very important. What a way to end our program today.
Yes, and let me tell you something about him. He's the senior pastor in Sukasa Church in Collegedale, Tennessee, and he's a doctor in psychology. He's a man of God, and I can't wait to listen from him.
Yes, because I need to believe in myself so that when I leave this program today, it will not stay here, but I can go sharing my legacy because I have a self-esteem that is as high as God's heaven, and I can share with others.
So let us see what he is in store for us.
We leave Dr. Gamaliel with you.
Hello, everybody. I'm Dr. Gamaliel Feliciano, Pastor Gamaliel Feliciano. I go by Dr. Gamma or Pastor Gamma. The youngest generation in my church call me Pastor G. You can call me that way. My wife call me beautiful, but that is just her. So I'm extremely happy to be with you today. Thank you, Noemi, as well. Noemi Torres for your job. It is my prayer that God will continue guiding you on your duties in the conference. New Jersey Conference is a great conference because of its people. I have a few good friends working there, and I was working at the same union until a year ago, the Columbia Union. I was at the Potomac Conference pastoring there. Right now, I'm with the Georgia Cumberland Conference, working as the senior pastor of the Sukasa Church that is on campus, on the Southern Adventist University campus in Tennessee. So receive our love from here. I'm married 20 years, married with a beautiful woman called Lorna. She's a civil engineer, and I have two girls. Beautiful. They are beautiful as me now. Lorena is 18 years old. She's a freshman at Andrews University. And Ara is a high schooler. She's studying in high school. I've been a psychologist as well, a licensed psychologist since 2008, some years ago. So to talk about these topics as today, to talk about our value before God's eyes, and for God, you know, our value in God, and how that relates to my relationships with others and to my family and to a healthy living is one of my passions. So I'm extremely happy to be here and to be doing this with you with you today, with you in mind. So thank you for being with me. Stay with me for a few minutes. It's not going to be long, but hopefully it's going to be useful. It's going to be a blessing. That is my prayer, and I know that God can do it. Let's pray. Let's start with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Lord, thank you, Father, for the blessing that it is to be with this beautiful woman at the New Jersey Conference. Thank you for the leaders that have decided to create this program, this event for them. And we ask you, God, to speak to us at this time and to touch our hearts. We are extremely happy to be in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. How do you value yourself? How valuable are you? Do you have some value? How do you perceive yourself? How do you feel about that value? Those are a few questions that hopefully we are going to answer today. Our topic is woman, self-worth, and self-esteem. And I would like to start by sharing with you a definition of precisely self-esteem. This is the element that we are going to emphasize as we have this conversation today. Self-esteem is an inner sense of worthiness that gives a person resilience and resistance in difficult times, especially when you have an attack against you or criticism. Okay, so is this inner sense of worthiness? To understand it a little bit better, let me tell you something. Generally speaking, each person has a concept about his or her self-worth, which may be or may not be accurate. Okay, that's another topic. But every one of us have this concept of how much or how valuable we are. And self-esteem is how the person feels about that concept. Are you following me so far? Does that make sense? Okay, so you have this concept about you, about how valuable are you, about your self-worth. And self-esteem is this emotional part, is how you feel about that concept. Having a self-esteem, a healthy self-esteem, is not to have an overblown ego. You know, it's not to have being proud or having an overblown view of who you are, of your importance. And one of the way you can measure if you are on that side of the path that is not the right one is when you start to look at other people and say, oh, I'm better than them. Or thank you, God, that I'm not like them. Or when you start to use nicknames for other people, oh, those are the Pharisees, because they think like that. I have never had that problem. No, we all have that problem. You know, we all have some, we have sins. We sin differently, but we're still sinning. We have weaknesses. You know, we all have our baggage, let's say like that. So when we talk about self-esteem, it's not about this egocentric idea of ourselves. It's not to see ourselves through a lens that will overblow who we are. It's not like that. Okay, we could reach a healthy self-esteem and also a healthy self-worth, or an understanding of a healthy understanding of our worth. So far, so good? Okay, very good. So sometimes it is easier to understand these concepts when we go to the negative. So allow me to make a list of how the low self-esteem manifests. In that way, you can see and you can put a check mark and you say, okay, maybe I need to get better in this area or this other area. Okay, So if you're ready, I'm going to put it on the screen. You can write it down, or I can share this presentation with Noemi later for you to have. That's not a problem. Okay, so the first one is that low self-esteem manifests in feelings of self-hate, believing that one is unworthy or incompetent. I don't know if you are getting this, and this is very common among Christians, sadly, as we understand the impact of sin in our lives. When we understand that we received from our parents, from Adam and Eve, this nature of sin and the inclination to sin, we start to feel unworthy. We start to feel incompetent. And don't get me wrong. Do not get me wrong. We are unworthy. We are unworthy, at least for getting salvation, to justify ourselves, to save ourselves. We are unworthy. We cannot provide a thing for our salvation. However, and this is a big but. This is a big however here. We should not consider ourselves unworthy when we are living in Christ, because look at this. See, God. Yes, God is telling us you are unworthy. Your justice is not enough. You don't even have a life to offer. You're dead. You're dead. You have only death to offer. But, however, I'm going to give you an answer. I'm going to give you a solution. I already gave you a solution. That solution is Jesus Christ. So when we live in Jesus Christ, we can say, as Paul mentions, you are not living anymore, but Jesus is living in you, and you are living in Jesus Christ. Okay? So this is the answer to this question. Are you unworthy? Yes and no. Yes, when I'm not living with Christ, but since I'm living in Christ, I am worthy, because my value does not come from myself or from the circumstances around me. My value comes from God, Okay? So this is one of the way the low self-esteem manifests. Let's continue with the other ones. There is a refusal to get close to people, believing one doesn't deserve strong or supportive relationships. Or there is a refusal to trust others. You know, when you see yourself as unworthy, you say, why should I pursue this relationship? I don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. And because we think that we don't deserve it, we embrace the idea that that someone will leave us, will abandon us, okay? And the relationship will be broken. So in order to avoid that hurtful status when somebody goes away or when a relationship is broken, we tend to avoid the relationship at all. And we don't trust people. So far, so good. Let's continue. Also, low self-esteem manifests itself in the rejection of what God intended the person to be in him. Mm-hmm. We're going to see that in a little bit and in a deeper way. In depression, in suicidal thoughts, in a need for lots of attention. We go to the other side of the spectrum with that. A competitive spirit, or even poor decisions that are made based on fears and not reality. However, look at this. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7, Paul gives us something that is so powerful if we are going through an episode, or if we have a mindset that is rooted in low self-esteem. He says, And because you are sons, I would love to put there daughters. Okay, so go with me. Galatians chapter 4, 6 and 7. And because you are daughters, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. That is daddy. In other words, the word Abba is the lovely nickname for father is daddy. Daddy or dada. Some people say dada. Daddy. Therefore, you are no longer slave, but a daughter. And if a daughter, then an heir of God through Christ. Okay, you are about to receive the kingdom of God with Christ. That's powerful. That's so great. That's so great. However, we need to understand how our self-esteem could be established in our lives. Because sometimes we're so focused on the wrong things and the wrong sources that we missed the opportunity to have a healthy self-esteem that is rooted in God's heart, in God's mind, in God Himself. So people's self-esteem is in trouble when they allow others to assess and convince them of their value. That is a wrong search. Sometimes we think that what other people think about us or believe about us is what is the things that determine my value and then my self-esteem. Hopefully today we're gonna see it differently. We're going to see that God is the one that determines our value, self-worth, and our self-esteem. And there is a great news about that. There are great news about it. Because God is constant. You know, God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He's the one. He's constant. Our circumstances are always changing. People around us are always changing. Their beliefs about us are always changing. So if today you are looking for confirmation about your value on Facebook, on your likes, on your followers on Instagram, you're gonna be sad all the time because people change, you know? People change and their beliefs about you, their concepts about you, their what they think about you will be changing all the time. Poor self-esteem is often the result of prolonged periods of negative feedback. So we need to take care of that. We need to consider how we are receiving the feedback of other people because that has an impact in us. There's something that we cannot deny, and is that society is constantly assessing our value. And we do it the same thing. We are all the time assessing the value of our kids, and we ask them, what are you going to be when you grow up? And if they say something that we don't like, we try to change their mind. You know, it's difficult to see that and not to be impacted by those words. Words have power and work. We have performance evaluations. We are graded in schools. We are evaluated for loans. Assessment of our value begins early in life and continues even after we are dead or not. Yes, it does. It does. Believe me, I'm a pastor. I do funerals. I do those type of services, and I hear people, you know, expressing about those that have passed. Thank God that most of the time are positive remarks. What we hear in those type of services, But we know that after the service is another story. So everybody is assessing us all the time. However, again, I have to say it again, and you will hear me mentioning this a few times during our conversation. God has determined our value. How valuable are you, your self-worth, and then your self-esteem is determined by God. It's in us if we believe it or not. It's in us if we are going to live based on what God thinks about us and the way God sees us or not. Or not. So what God says about you, who does God say I am? I'm going to give you just a few things. God says a lot of things about us, a lot of good, great things about us. I'm going to give you only five. God says that you are a child of God. You are a child of God. We read in the Bible constantly that God is calling us His children. His children. You are a child of God. You are new creation. You are new creation. Not only that, you are a masterpiece. And I love this one, you know. I love this one. When we go to Genesis and we read about the creation of Eve, of the woman, the words that Moses used to describe that creation, the creation of Eve, the creation of woman, he's using a word that is more connected to architecture, you know, a special designed. You were created in a special way as a woman, and I'm so happy that you are starting to understand that. You know, because you are so special. You are so special. The narrative in Genesis makes clear that man was incomplete. You know, we were not complete. We were not going to be happy without you girls. So you are a masterpiece. Tell that to the person next to you. If you're in a group, tell that to the person next to you. Text, come on, send a text to someone and with just that phrase. You are a masterpiece. You are a masterpiece. But also he says that we are friends and mostly that we are loved. I love that one too. We are loved. So how can we connect that to who we are in Jesus, who we are in God, who we are as human beings, but also as children of God, you as a daughter of God, to identify our worth, to establish our self-esteem on healthy ground, we need to look at our identity, to our identity, and to identify that part, to look at our identity, we need to go back to the beginning. We need to go back to creation. And I'm going to share with you only three simple things that are that will tell us how we need to live as we understand who we are. Okay, so far so good? Are you with me? Okay, let's go to Genesis then. Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1 will give us a few things that we are, a few things that we should practice, a few concepts that we need to internalize in order to live them. So Genesis chapter 1 talks about creation. You know that. Talks about creation. And I have three verses on the screen. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, 27, and verse 28. And there are three principles that I want to share with you. I'm going to stay in this screen. Let me see if I can share my image as well. Okay, I'm here. Perfect. So let's read it together, and hopefully we are going to get or learn a few things about these verses. It says, "Then God said," the word God used there is Elohim, used to present the plurality of God. Okay. "Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish, etc." We are going to continue with that verse in a little bit. The first concept that we need to understand is that God created you to be relational. Whoops, no, it doesn't fit. Yeah, no. Relational, okay? Relational. God created you with the capacity to establish relationships because he is relational. You know, when we talk about God as a God of love, the main evidence that he is love, it is the way he promotes relationships. Relationships among himself, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, relationships with or a relationship with his children, Adam, Eve, you and me, also relationships with between us, the creation, the creatures. Okay, so God created you to be relational, and that will help you to identify who you are in him, to establish your identity. It's like a circle. This will help you to, you know, increase awareness of who you are, of your identity and your purpose. But at the same time, as you discover your real identity, more relationships, deeper relationships in love will be developed. Okay? So the first thing that we find is that God created you to be relational. Say it with me. I'm relational. I am relational. Look at this. Let's go to verse 27 now. Then he says, "So God created mankind in his own image, in the image of God. He created them, male and female, both of them. He created them." Notice this. When Moses wrote this chapter, there were no exclamation marks or other tools in grammar to emphasize what he wanted to emphasize. So something that was very common was to repeat certain words or phrases to emphasize the concept that he wanted to share. In this verse, it's obvious that Moses wanted us to realize that creation part, that creative part. And I do believe that part of our identity is that God created us to be creative. God not only created us to be relational, he created us to be creative as well. What does that mean, Pastor? Well, when you're looking to increase your self-worth, your self-esteem, we already established that that comes from God. And when I say that comes from God, is that when we understand our identity in God, it will increase our concept, our value, our self-value, self-worth, and how we feel about it, our self-esteem, okay? So God has given you the ability to create things, to create especially the way you will live. You know, his will is for you to decide. Sometimes we think that somebody is not following God's will because they are not following God's desires or even the main idea from God when he created us. And yes, God wants us to be saved. God wants us to enjoy that salvation today. God wants us to live in His presence, in our relationship with Him. But when someone decides not to go on that route, he or she is not against God's will, because God's will is for you to decide. That is an expression, a basic expression of love. You know, when we walk in love, when we love other people, we cannot keep them as prisoners. We need to give them freedom to choose. And if they want to stay with you, it's because they love you. That is freedom. That is one of the main qualities of love. So God is giving you the opportunity to choose. To choose how you're going to live. He will give you His desire. He will give you His plans for you. He created you to be saved. He created you to be with Him. And He is fulfilling His part of the pact. However, is on your hands if you're going to decide to be on that side. Hopefully you are. And if you are on God's plans, even though you are in God's plans, he will say to you, I have a will that is the macro and that I'm going to give you. I want you to be, my will is for you to be safe, to be loved, to be happy. How you're going to apply those in your own life is on you. Okay. What ministry are you going to follow? Who you're going to marry? How many kids will you have? I don't know. All those things are on you. And God gave you the opportunity to be creative. God gave you the capacity, the ability to be creative. Okay? So when we are looking for identity and purpose of life, sometimes it's good to be creative in the way we do things. Maybe to go back to those things that we used to do and we are not doing anymore that were great for our life, our spiritual life mainly. Or maybe to explore new possibilities, new practices, new ways of thinking about God and His mission on earth. My life with God and my life with my neighbor. And understanding that my first neighbor is, in your case, your husband. Yeah, that's your neighbor. I know that sometimes you don't like your neighbor, but he's the one. So be creative. Be creative. Not only enjoy the relationship or the capacity, the ability to be relational, but also enjoy the ability to be creative. Is a gift from God. Look at the verse 28, and we find another great thing in verse 28. It says, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Notice that this message was for both of them, okay? For them. Not only for men, but also for women. Okay? So be fruitful, increase in number, fill the earth, be fruitful, and also subdue it. Subdue it. And that is connected to the phrase used in verse 26 when it says, you may rule over the fish, you and the birds and the rest of the animals. So in other words, Moses is talking about kingdoms. Okay? Moses is telling us God created you to be in one of the kingdoms. We have two kingdoms expressed in these verses. We have God's kingdom and the animal kingdom. Okay? And God is telling us through Moses, I want you to live in my kingdom over the animal kingdom. In the animal kingdom, people do things as they please, by instinct, and not necessarily in love. So God is creating you, has created you to enjoy His kingdom. When you would start to enjoy His kingdom, and Jesus came to earth to teach us about that. Jesus came to earth to teach us about an atypical a non-typical kingdom in which he is present, God is present, in which the actions of its citizens is based on love and compassion, a kingdom that is eternal. So Jesus came on earth, came to live among us to teach us about that kingdom, to teach us that we can start, to live on that kingdom today, a kingdom of love, a kingdom where the main trait is that of its citizens is that they love each other. They love God and they love each other. And everything is filtered through that concept, through that premise, that principle, to love God and to love each other. Okay? So three things we found in Genesis about our identity. Number one, God created you to be relational. God created you to be creative. And God created you to enjoy his kingdom. And you could ask, hey, pastor, that sounds great, but I need action. I need something to do. How can I work on my self-worth as a woman? How can I work on my self-esteem? Well, I'm going to give you five action steps. Write them down, please. Okay. Hopefully you can apply them later on. Five action steps. Number one is recognize your value. Recognize your value. There is a difference. Listen up. There is a difference between having an inflated ego and simply understanding your significance based on your God-given gifts and your value to him. So far, we have been seeing how God created you to be relational, to be creative, to enjoy his kingdom. We have seen how he called us his children. We are kings, we are queens, we are loved, we are friends. All of those are signs of how God sees us. He sees us with love, with value. So what can I do, Pastor? Okay, start by making a list of 10 talents, character traits, physical traits, abilities, accomplishments, and so on that set you apart. You have many things that set you apart, not because you are better than other people, but because you are special. Okay, that's very different. God says that you are special. You are very, very special. Okay, so identify other positive people as well and spend more time with them. Recognize your value. Start to practice the main idea of God when he created you. Those three things that I already gave you will give you value. When you start to develop relationships, meaningful, loving relationships on purpose. Maybe you are an introvert. I'm an introvert. And sometimes it's difficult to start new relationships for an introvert. A little bit easier for an extrovert that enjoy or is recharged by social interaction. For an introvert, it's not that we are antisocial or asocial. No, we love to be social. God created us that way. So we are. But we are more selective, okay? Or we have more deeper relationships with less people. So maybe you are on that side of the spectrum. Maybe you are more an introvert. Be intentional. It's not about creating 10 new relationships, meaningful relationships, focused on one or two. Yeah, people from the church, your neighbors, your coworkers, maybe family members. I don't know. Okay, so identify other people, positive people, and spend more time with them. Make a list. Recognize your value. Number two, stop harmful thought patterns. Stop them. You know, we are fed by beliefs that are irrational. And and we believe them. Sometimes they come from other people that tells you, for example, that you are not valuable because you made a mistake in your past. Maybe you got pregnant early, and because of that, some people say, okay, you're good, but you know that BOT, but it cancels everything that you say. Or maybe you are divorced, or maybe you are single. You have been single your whole life, or maybe you did all the things that are not connected to your relationships. Okay, do not allow them to tell you who you are when God has already told you. He already told you who you are, and you are His daughter. Allow that to marinate. Allow that to bring some roots, to develop some roots. You are the daughter of the King, not a regular king, the King of Kings. So stop harmful thought patterns. Galatians 2:20. Remember, I mentioned that earlier. I have been crucified with Christ. I is no longer who I live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. So a few things in this topic, in this point. Consider some of the thought patterns and other factors that are leading you to believe lies about your worth. Consider them. Write them down. Talk with someone about them. Everyone influences others, as I mentioned. And chances are that you have had a positive influence on some people. So that's good too, to realize that even when you feel like trash, even when you feel like alone in this world, somebody is grateful for you. Somebody is very grateful for you. Somebody is thinking about you. So think back on things you have done, such as teaching the Sabbath school class, or being with the kids, or helping with the Pathfinders, or giving a perfect gift to a relative. Maybe you taught a child to shoot a basketball, or taking a bag of groceries to a food pantry, invited a new co-worker to lunch, or a new attendant to the church to lunch in your house. All those things could be small in front of us, at our eyes, but at the same time, they are great things because they point out something bigger in us. And it's the fact that we love people, that we are relational, that we are creative, and that we are living in God's kingdom. So far, so good? Hopefully it is. Number three, begin new thought patterns. You know, it is important not only to cancel, to eliminate those things that are affecting us, but it's also important to replace them with good things. I'm going to teach you something that is very simple, but also significant. I love this concept, so I'm going to teach this to you if you allow me. I'm going to open my screen, my white screen. I'm here. Okay. So everybody moves based on their needs. Okay. Needs are the one that our need is the one that motivates us. We act based on needs. In other words, our behaviors are motivated by our needs. Okay? Our needs are positive all the time. They are positive. We have a need to be loved, to belong, to be accepted, to have certain level of control, etc. Those are good needs. However, we fulfill those needs with behaviors that are not always, they are not always positive. Our behaviors could be positive or negative. And the thing is that those behaviors, both the positive or the negative, connected to our needs, will fulfill the need. Okay? We'll fulfill the need. It will take you to fulfillment. Right? However, this fulfillment, when it's positive, will give you, I'm sorry, I'm thinking in Spanish today, healthy and permanent changes, or fulfillment, healthy and permanent fulfillment when it's positive, when the behavior is positive. But when it's negative, this fulfillment will be temporary and even counterproductive. Okay? So both behaviors will fulfill the needs. Our needs provoke or produce our behaviors. Our behaviors will fulfill our needs. Both the positive and the negative will fulfill the needs. However, as I mentioned, if we use positive behaviors, the fulfillment will be more healthy and permanent. If we use negative behaviors, the fulfillment will be temporary and counterproductive. For example, if you have the need of love for a father figure, let's say like that, father figure, love, you have a few options to fulfill that need. The positive one is to go to an uncle, grandpa, a pastor, or any other figure, male figure that will help you. And this example goes mostly for teenagers or young people, but even adults could be struggling with this type of need. So one positive way is to substitute this element that we are missing with something that is more healthy, as good relationships with this type of people. Or you could go through the negative and do, for example, sex, even premarital, or with several partners. That's a bad behavior to fulfill this need. Will this fulfill the need of love? Some people will say, no, it won't. But the reality is that it will. It will fulfill this need. However, the fulfillment will be temporary and counterproductive. Temporary because it's not going to last. Counterproductive because it will cause more issues than those that will be solved. Okay? So this is important to understand, because when we are breaking these thought patterns, when we are developing new patterns, we need to understand our needs. We need to look at our needs and say, okay, this is what I need. This is why I'm acting this way. Okay? It's needed. Number four, be patient. It is a process. It has taken years of bad habits to get to where you are with your self-esteem. So healing will not happen overnight and will require replacing the bad thought patterns with good ones. It may take a while until your reflex action is quick to respond in a proactive way to negative thinking. It will take time. And number five, and this is the most important, of course, connect with God. Connect with God. Connect with God through prayer, through the reading of the Bible, the study of the Bible. Have journals. I bought this one not too long ago, and I really love it. It's a series. it gives you, I haven't started, but I'm going to start. It gives you per book the space to read and then write your impression. It's journaling, right? And there comes Bibles and apps, and or you can use a notebook. But do it. Do it. Connect with God. That is very important. Connect with God. And it's not only about reading. It's not only about praying. It's also about relationships. Connect with God through your relationships with other people. So five action steps for you. Recognize your value. Stop harmful thought patterns. Begin new thought patterns. Be patient and connect with God. Today, my call to you is very simple. God is calling you to receive Him, to understand that He's the one that will give you your real identity. And as He gives you your real identity and purpose of life, your self-worth will be increased. You will perceive yourself the same way God see you, the same way God consider you, and you will feel great. Your self-esteem will be in the place that God wants it to be, that God wants you to be. Thank you for listening. Thank you for sharing this, for spending this time with me. Hopefully you understood and you received something. I apologize if I mispronounced a few words. As I mentioned, my switch is in Spanish today. I just preached in Spanish and I'm in that flow. So we love you. Stay healthy. Stay spiritual. Stay a daughter of God. Continue being a queen of God. Father, bless these beautiful women. Continue with them. Guide them. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, family. Bye-bye. Until next time.
Oh, this is what I was waiting for, and I hope that you're having the same sentiments. Oh, wow, Aldith. Wasn't that inspiring to know that when I take care of myself, I can in turn take care of others?
Yes, and it is really, really important to believe in yourself. Isn't it?
It is. And that is how we are going to make it. Because a lot of times, because of how we are treated, we think we are not precious in God's sight, mm-hmm. but we are. Listen to this quote from Sharon Salzberg. She says, you yourself, not anyone else, you mm-hmm. yourself, as much as anybody in the entire universe, deserve your love and affection. So this is telling me that if I don't love myself first, and that is something that I'm deserving of, then I can't give it to others. How important it is to know that I have this self-esteem to go forth knowing that I am created by God, our loving Lord, and to have this really, really beautiful thing about myself so that wherever I go, I don't have to bow in shame, but I can hold my head up high and I can express to others that, you know what? You also can be like this. And also that when they see how loved you are and you share love with them, they in turn can love themselves and share love to others. What do you think?
Yes. If you love yourself, it is like having mirror upon yourself and you reflect that affection and you can also share that love to others.
I believe so. And this is such a great, great topic to finish this afternoon. Yes. And I'm sure that all of us were blessed. And don't forget, share the link with your friends and families because we don't want them to be left. We are so thankful that we were so blessed today, and I'm sure you were also. And at this time, we will not forget those who labored so much behind the scenes. And we are going to place our gratitude right now to all of those who had this beautiful program put together. And first, we are going to thank all the speakers. We were so blessed from Friday night
Amen.
Until this afternoon, right? Mm-hmm. We want to thank the Richards, both husband and wife. We want to thank them for their inspiration and those timely messages they gave us. We want to thank also Miriam Salcedo, and we will not forget that Marianne was there also giving us such an awesome message about our interpersonal relationship. There at the end, that we felt that our esteem had been lifted so much, we want to thank Dr. Feliciano for such a warm message. And two, we have people who gave so much testimony. Mm-hmm. We had so many testimonies and songs, and we had people playing instruments. Oh, this was an overall blessing yes. for all of us.
Also, which is Miss Stacy Brown. We would like to thank her also for such an inspiring message.
Yes.
And of course, we would like to thank the New Jersey Conference Department of the Communication, the administration, and the Women's Ministry Department who put all this amazing program for us to enjoy.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone.
Amen.
I will go.
So after so many speakers and so many wonderful, interesting topics, we want to tell you that we are happy that we have been fed today. But don't forget, it doesn't stop here. Next year, we don't know what will happen, if we will be in person, which is very good for us, or if we be online, the same as this year. Whatever happens,
either way,
right, surely we will be back. Right, yes. Aldith?
Yes, 2022.
Are you ready?
I am ready.
I am ready to hear some more of these inspiring message. But what will we do first? We can't stay here. We will have to go
sharing our legacy.
May God bless you. Let's have a word of prayer to close. And we hope that you will be filled with the Holy Spirit to go forward. Let's pray. Loving Father, what an awesome weekend we have passed. We have been fed by not only the speakers that came to us, but your holy presence. We want to thank you, Lord, for sending such a spiritual feast. We have eaten, we have been blessed, and now we are ready for the charge to go and share our legacy. So help us day by day as we walk in your spirit and in your light, that others that passes by, that sees us, that see our action and feel our words in their lives, that they too might receive these blessings and will be empowered to go forward sharing this great legacy. We pray that you will continue to be with us. Be with those who are in their homes, wherever they are, and help them that they too will share this link, share these messages with their loved ones, their friends, their neighbors, so they also will receive the joy of your salvation. Bless us now, we pray, and we ask that you will go with us as we leave this audience this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.